follow the evidence where it goes.
Nobody's ever called up and said, I am directing you, you must stop. Nobody's ever tried to stop.
I never thought of quitting.
People who choose to engage in corruption in our district do so knowing the risks.
You do need to prosecute corruption. If you see someone abusing the law or not doing what they should be doing.
We caught 10 lawyers in his chambers paying bribes to him to dismiss narcotics cases.
We also, along the way, prosecuted people who lied in the grand jury.
If you do anything to expose a source, or, I mean, not only will that source never talk to you again, but nobody will ever talk to you again.
When anyone asked the prosecuting attorney, the old prosecutor, what's about this, what's about that, he said, I don't know anything about that. No comment.
Number one, be involved and insist on knowing what your government's doing. You have a right to know, even if the law doesn't recognize it, we all have a right to know what our government is doing.
Shteti Illinois në SHBA është vendi që është përballur më së shumti me korrupsion të nivelit të lartë. Përveç prokurorëve, gjyqtarëve, avokatëve, nën punësve civil, koka e korrupsionit ishin edhe drejtuesit të këtij shteti, guvernatorët. Një nga skandalet më të mëdha të nivelit të lartë të korrupsionit është edhe rasti i guvernatorit Rod Blagojevich, i cili mori drejtimin e këtij shteti në vitin 2002. I njëjti uzu të jetë i përfshirë në një aferë që lidhej me ndërtimin e një spitali, por edhe në vepra tjera që lidheshin me korrupsion dhe interesimin e tij për të mbetur në pushtet. Një nga prokurorët e rastit, Diane MacArthur, tregon si filloi hetimi.
In 2003, a businesswoman named Pam Davis found out that in order to build a second hospital with which she was associated, she was told that she would have to hire a specific builder or contractor. And she felt that she was being extorted, shaken down, and forced to hire somebody that she really didn't want to hire. And so she went to the FBI, told the FBI about what had happened, and then agreed to cooperate with the FBI by way of recording conversations with the person providing the financing and then also with that contractor.
MacArthur thot se nuk ishte e lehtë të zgjeroj hetimit deri te guvernatori, gjithçka u sqarua rrugës me arrestimin e personit të parë i cili pranoi të bashkëpunojë. Nga i njëjti, përmes përgjimit të bisedave dhe pesë dëshmitarëve, u konkludua dhe u vërtetua përfshirja e guvernatorit Blagojevich në këtë rast.
The governor Blagojevich was very interested in raising money to fund his campaign to be reelected. And through discussions of other people and then the governor himself, it became clear that the governor wanted to try to get benefits for himself, either in the form of campaign contributions or positions for himself, should he not run for office as governor again, by way of exchanging what he wanted to receive by way of benefits for state actions. For example, increased funding for a local children's hospital, or favorable legislation for a racetrack.
Në vitin 2006, Blagojevic fitoi mandatin e dytë për goditja më e madhe e guvernatorit i erdhi në një nga përgjimet më të rëndësishme që uzu. A i bënte përpjekje që përmes përfitimeve financiare ta plotësonte vendin në Senat, pasi atë e kishte liruar Barack Obama, i cili u zgjall në atë kohë president i Shteteve të Bashkuara të Amerikës.
Interesting at the time arrangement that the governor was recorded and trying to make was what was known as the Senate seat arrangement. And at that time, then Senator Obama had just been elected President of the United States. And we were able to capture through the wiretap conversations by Governor Blagojevich where he was trying to parlay the person who would be appointed to fill the Senate seat, something that he as governor could do by way of a benefit to himself.
Diana tregon se në atë kohë presioni ishte jashtëzakonshëm. Media ishte interesuar të kuptoj se çfarë po ndodh. Rasti Blagojevich rrugës doli të jetë më i madh, pasi përgjimet nxorën në shesh edhe më shumë veprime tjera të guvernatorit, gjë që bëri të zgjerohet rjeti i personave të akuzuar. Pas shumë seancave e dëshmi të forta, Blagojevich u denua në vitin 2009 me 14 vite burg, duke u shkarkuar edhe nga pozita që mbante. Edhe apeli për kundër diskutimeve të gjata i arri konfirmoj dënimin. Blagojevich aktualisht po vuan dënimin në një nga burgjet e Colorados.
We don't intentionally pursue or prosecute high profile people. Follow the evidence where it goes. And then the Blagojevich case is a very good example of that. It started very small.
Historia për fshirjes në korrupsion të guvernatorëve në Illinois është e gjatë. Një nga rastet tjera është edhe ai i guvernatorit George Ryan, që pasi u zgjat në këtë pozitë, u hetua dhe u gjetë që ishte i përfshirë në marrje të rishfetit për financimin e fushatës së tij drejt postit të guvernatorit. Në fakt, gjithçka filloi derisa Ryan ishte sekretari i shtetit. Ai përmes nën punësve civil lëshonte licenca për shofer pa ndonjë kriter dhe në këmbim të saj merrte mito, të cilat shfrytëzoheshin për investimet në fushatën e tij. Lauri Barcella ishte prokurore në këtë rast. Ajo tregon se si lindën dyshimet e para që quan të hetimet për guvernatorin.
Well, the investigation that led to the prosecution of George Ryan began in the mid-1990s with the allegations about bribes being given to officials with the Department of Motor Vehicles. In Illinois, it's the Illinois Secretary of State's office that manages all of the motor vehicle registrations and driver's licenses. And so they have the Secretary of State's office has offices throughout the state of Illinois. And George Ryan, in the mid-1990s, was the Illinois Secretary of State. He was the head of that department. And so there were driver's license facilities all throughout Illinois. And there were allegations that civil servants, people who were working for the state of Illinois at these driver's license facilities were taking bribes.
Por një aksident në rrugët e Illinois që shkaktoi vdekjen e 6 fëmijëve të një familje, zbuloi gjithçka. Shoferi që shkaktoi aksidentin kishte marr patent shoferi jo të rregullt, pasi për të varu shpejt. Ndjekja nisi të zgjerohet përmes përgjimeve dhe gjithçka shumë shpejt doli në sipërfaqe.
Once those prosecutions started happening, the civil servants who were being prosecuted began to cooperate and talk about what they were doing with the money that they received through bribery. And many of them said that the reason why they were taking bribes and what they were doing with the money was they were giving it to George Ryan, basically their boss, to his campaign fund. Because George Ryan was a politician, and although he was Secretary of State at the time, he had other ambitions in politics.
Hetimet u zgjeruan edhe më shumë, pasi aty doli të jetë i përfshirë edhe një person i dytë shumë i afërt me George Ryan. Është fjala për Scott Favell.
He also was the campaign chairman, and he was the one who would give the directives to all these workers that they had to contribute to the campaign. He was basically the man who gave out the orders. And he was the one who made sure that the investigation of this horrible accident didn't go very far. Scott Faywell went to trial, and he was convicted. And so shortly after his conviction, he decided to cooperate. He was not an easy witness because he was very loyal to George Ryan, but he started to tell us more about the workings of the campaign and the Secretary of State's office. By this time, George Ryan had become the governor. He had been elected governor, and so now the investigation was really about a sitting governor. And we kept going with it. And Scott Faywell, at a certain point after he was convicted, he decided to cooperate. We also, along the way, prosecuted people who lied in the grand jury.
Hetimi u konkludua, prova të gjetën, procesi gjyqësor u zhvillua në një kohë të gjatë, ndërsa George Ryan ishte guvernatori i radhës i Illinoisit, i cili në vitin 2006 u dënua dhe vuajti dënimin prej 6 vitesh borgu. Ryan gjatë gjithë procesit hetimor, gënjeu prokurorët dhe hetuesit. I njëjti merr të rishfet para e pushime dhe hetuesit gjetën prova për të gjitha këto. Trupi gjykues dhe prokuroria për më shumë se 10 vite hetimi ka përfshirë dhe dënuar në këtë rast 76 persona. Guvernatorët dhe përfshirja atyre në korrupsion nuk ishin të vetmit në Illinois. Imun në këtë drejtim nuk ishin as prokurorët e gjyqtarët. Operacioni Grey Lord, pas viteve 1970, nxori në sipërfaqe përfshirjen në një sistemi të tërë të drejtësisë në korrupsion. Avokatët, prokurorët, gjyqtarët, të gjithë njëri me tjetrin bashkëpunonin, merrnin mito dhe ndikonin në vendimet dhe në rastet kriminale. Tërë këtë zbulim e nisi Terry Hake, një prokuror i asaj kohe që u bë figura kyçe e këtij procesi. Ai gjatë punës së tij filloi të vërej se diçka nuk shkonte, pasi për raste të rënda, duke përfshirë edhe vrasje, kishte akt gjykime liruese. Ai tregon se si vendosi të punojë si agent i fshehur me organe tjera hetuese.
For 3 years and 7 months I worked undercover as an attorney in the court system. My first 9 months were working undercover in the state's attorney's office as an undercover prosecutor, taking bribes from defense attorneys in narcotics court. And after 9 months of doing that, the FBI and the U.S. Attorney's office asked me to quit the prosecutor's office, and they made me an undercover criminal defense lawyer. And I did that for another 2.5 years. And after the undercover phase of Grey Lord ended, we went to trial in the federal building in Chicago in the court system, and we were on trial for 10 years, which was an amazing long length of time. And so I testified for 10 years in federal court after the undercover investigation ended.
Hake rëfën se në fillim e kishte të vështirë të bind FBI që të filloj hetimet mbi pretendimet e ti, por gjithçka bëri kthesen në një rast vrasje.
And one thing that convinced them that they had to act was a murder case that was fixed for bribes in 1977. It involved a hitman for organized crime in Chicago, the Chicago Mafia, Al Capone's old organization. And he was a hitman, and he was charged with murder, but found not guilty of murder by a judge at the criminal courthouse. And we later learned, almost 10 years later, that he had paid a $10,000 bribe to that judge to be found not guilty of murder.
Terry thot se kruciale ishte puna e tij si agent i fshehur që ka bërë. Kjo si pas ti ka qenë pika kryesore pasi ai pranon të rushfetën nga avokat në mënyrë që të ndikojnë në rastet të caktuara.
I did both. I My first 9 months as a prosecutor, I took bribes from four attorneys to dismiss felony narcotics cases in drug court. And I also, during that 9 months, developed the evidence, the probable cause to bug the judge's chambers, to put a legal wiretap in the judge's chambers. And that was a first for law enforcement in the United States, because a judge's chambers in the United States had never been bugged before. So we did that. The bug was in the judge's chambers for 6 weeks. We were listening to his conversations. We caught 10 lawyers in his chambers paying bribes to him to dismiss narcotics cases.
Hetimi zyrtar në rastin Grey Lord filloi në vitin 1980 dhe zgjati deri në vitin 1983. Përfundimi I provave nxori në pa se si gjyqtarët, prokurorët korruptoheshin me shuma të vogla 50 deri në 300 dollar. Terry Hake, kur u paraqit në gjykat gjatë proceseve, ai me vete kishte 364 përgjime, të cilat sqaruan gjithçka në detaje. Terry qëndroi përballë hetimit përkundër rreziqeve të mëdha që kishte përpara.
I never worried about myself. I never thought of quitting. But when I started this case, I was 28 years old and living with my parents. When the undercover phase ended, I was married. My wife was pregnant. So I never worried about myself, but you'd worry about your family. Because even in the 80s, the FBI installed a sophisticated burglar alarm system in my house. But even in the 1980s, if they really wanted to kill you, they could just put a remote control bomb in your evergreen tree.
Pa dyshim që procesi Grey Lord vlerësohet të jetë një ndër më të mëdhenjt kundër korrupsionit në SBA. U akuzuan e u gjykuan 103 persona, të gjithë u dënuan. Aty ishin 20 gjyqtar, mbi 54 avokat, prokuror e zyrtar policor. Grey Lord ka shënuar kthesën e madhe kundër korrupsionit në drejtësi. Në fakt ky proces ka ndryshuar shumë çka, dhe në Illinois funksionon çdo gjë ndryshe pas këtij operacioni. Gjitha proceset e mëdha kundër korrupsionit në Illinois kanë shtuar nevojën për hetime më të mëdha në të gjitha nivelet në vend. Sot institucionet e drejtësisë atje vazhdojnë punë në disa raste hetimi për përfshirje në korrupsion. John Kokoras është asistenti par I prokurorit të shtetit në Illinois. Ai tregon se hetimet nuk lidhen me ndikimet politike, asçka përfaqëson individi. Ata thot ai ndjekin provat dhe kjo është par më së miri në rastin e dy guvernatorëve. Kokoras thot se të gjithë njerëzit që duan të korruptohen tashmë I kuptojnë rreziqet që I vijnë nga organet e hetuesisë.
People who choose to engage in corruption in our district do so knowing the risks. They know that we will pursue investigations and prosecutions of public corruption using the same techniques and with the same zeal that we pursue drug dealers and violent criminals. And we will pursue public corruption wherever we have jurisdiction, even if parts of the schemes occur outside of our district or even outside of our country. I hope that our experience in addressing corruption in Chicago will help the people of Kosovo in their battle against corruption.
New York, një ndër metropolet më të mëdha botërore, nuk ka vetëm problem me krime të përditshme që raportohen aty. Korrupsioni është prezent edhe në këtë shtet, ndoshta jo në nivelet dhe në shkallën sikurse në Illinois, por institucione hetimore kryejnë punën edhe në hetimet për korrupsion. Mark Peters, komisioner në Departamentin e Hetimeve në New York, tregon se sa komplekse janë hetimet në fushën e përfshirjes në korrupsion. Ata hetojnë se cilin nën punës civil dhe të tjerë që janë angazhuar në departamentet të ndryshme në New York. Derisa për këtë, kanë angazhuar në institucionin e tyre 700 persona, të cilët kanë hetuar dhe sjell rezultate edhe në luftën kundër korrupsionit.
Last year we arrested roughly a little under 700 people. So we arrested a little under 700 people last year. for various corruption-related offenses. Now, some of those were city workers, and some of those were private contractors doing business with the city. And often, when we do the arrests, we end up arresting groups of both. So in other words, if we arrest, we may end up, to give you two examples, one of the agencies we look at is the Department of Correction, which runs the city's jails. So we've done several large cases where we've arrested outsiders for bribing prison guards to smuggle in contraband, and then we've arrested the prison guards, city employees, for bringing in the contraband, and then in some cases we've rearrested the people on the inside who are then distributing the contraband in the city's jails.
Komisioneri Peters thot më tej se njerëzit që merren me hetime duhet të kenë integritet dhe të refuzojnë çdo lloj ndërhyrje në punën e tyre. Në të kundërtën, sipas tij ata duhet të largohen nga vendet e tyre të punës.
Nobody has ever, nobody's ever called up and said, I am directing you, you must stop. Nobody's ever tried to stop a full-on investigation. Certainly people have objected, certainly people have called and complained, but there's never been an instance where somebody explicitly said, if you do not stop this, we will move to get rid of you, largely because there's no way to move to get, it would be an empty threat. The most important point is the willingness to say no. In other words, people call up and complain, your guys showed up and took away a bunch of documents and didn't tell me why, and the first rule is the ability to say, yes, we went and took a bunch of documents and I'll let you know why when I'm done with my investigation, go away. If you're not prepared to say that, you shouldn't have my job. If you're not prepared for people to complain about what you're doing, you shouldn't have the job.
Jennifer Rogers është drejtuese e Fakultetit të Drejtësisë në Universitetin e Columbia's në New York, ndërsa më herët ishte angazhuar edhe si prokurore. Ajo flet për një nivel tjetër të korrupsionit në SBA, krahasuar me disa vende që kalojnë në tranzicion, siç kanë qenë edhe Kosova.
The US is different than some other countries in the world. We don't have really widespread corruption so that you have to do things like give a bribe to have your electricity turned on or things like that. But we do, like all countries, have public officials who are corrupt, who take money, put it in their pockets that should be taxpayer money, who do business with their friends, who give contracts to their friends, that sort of thing. So there's definitely corruption here, but it's not as widespread as it is in other places in the world. I think everyone's affected by corruption, no matter where you are. When your public officials are putting taxpayer funds in their pockets or giving contracts to their friends when their friends shouldn't be getting them, that trickles down to affect all citizens. So, it's not just an effect on a citizen if you have to give someone a bribe to, do something like that you need, like turn on your water. It's also affects them if our public officials are corrupt, because we need to have trust in our government.
Rogers aktualisht është angazhuar në një program ku janë të përfshirë mbi 10,000 njerëz, të cilët trajnohen dhe marrin praktika hetimi për të luftuar korrupsionin në nivelet ku punojnë. Ajo më tej thotë se forma të tilla të vendisimit duhet të ndiqen kudo, sepse në këtë mënyrë vijnë deri tek rezultati. Jennifer shton se korrupsioni nuk duhet të ketë tolerime, veçmas ndaj personave që fusin duart në parat e qytetarëve.
I think deterrence is important. I mean, I wouldn't want to say no mercy. That sounds really harsh, but you do need to prosecute corruption, and if called for, then you need to have a jail sentence on that. I think it's important to send the message that corruption won't be tolerated. One thing about prosecuting public officials and politicians is that they often feel entitled. They're powerful people. They've never been to prison. They're often wealthy people. So in order to send the message that no one is above the law and that they can't dip their hands into taxpayer money, it's a tough fight. I encourage them to stay strong and to keep it up. What's really important is that the institutions fighting corruption have independence. That's why non-governmental agencies are so important, because they're not tied to the government, so they can be independent. But when you have a governmental agency fighting corruption, which is obviously sometimes the most effective option because of the powers government has, you have to make sure that that agency has the independence it needs and also the resources that they need to do the job they need to do.
Pjesa kryesore dhe jo më pak e rëndësishme pos institucioneve të hetimit janë edhe mediat. Në New York veproi një numër i madh gazetarësh, televizione e media online, të cilat çdo ditë raportojnë për rastet e përfshirjes në korrupsion. Një nga ata është edhe gazetari i The New York Daily News, Graham Raymond, i cili zyrën e tij e ka brenda stacionit policor në New York. Raymond ka shkruar për një rast të përgjimeve ku të përfshir ishin drejtues të departamenteve të policisë, të cilët morën disa vendime jo ligjore. Raymond tregon se për korrupsionin është gjithmonë e vështirë të raportohet, marr parasysh edhe burimet që gjenden.
Sometimes there are people I know through and I meet them through people I know. But it's all about relationships. You know, you just try to get yourself out there, meet people, build relationships, build networks, you know. And then it's about trust. People have to trust you. And the only thing a good journalist has is their reputation. And if you do anything to expose a source, or I mean, not only will that source never talk to you again, but nobody will ever talk to you again.
Shteti i Washingtonit njihet për një ambient të pastër sa i përket korrupsionit, por në të kaluarën e largët, ky shtet dhe qyteti në Seattle ka pasur histori të mëdha të përfshirjes në korrupsion. Christopher Bailey, tani 80 vjeçar, ka punuar si prokuror në vitet e 70-ta. Atko u përfshi në hetime të një rasti të madh korrupsioni, ku ishin përfshirë policë të qytetit, të cilët merrnin rushfet nga biznesit e lojrave të fatit, në mënyrë që atyre tua mundsonin punën. Bailey është edhe autori një libri me titull Drejtësia në Seattle, që sqaron në detaje rastin.
The first things that happened were investigations by the two Seattle daily newspapers. Mid-60s and in 1968, there were a series of investigative reports in the papers. And everybody began to know about this. But when anyone asked the prosecuting attorney, the old prosecutor, what's about this, what's about that? He said, I don't know anything about that, no comment. And then there was a very famous event when a photographer for the morning paper, the Seattle PI, hid in the bushes near the house of Charles O'Carroll. And because they had been following a man named Ben Saichi, who held a master license for pinball machines in the county. And that sounds sort of small potatoes, but pinball machines involve a huge amount of money. And the whole essence of the corruption was the police were being paid off by people who ran bingo games or did other things in order to not arrest them, not investigate.
Bailey tregon se edhe teknikat e hetimit në atë kohë ishin të vështira pasi kishte pak njerëz të besueshëm që mund të llogarisnin.
The most important thing was to have investigators who you knew were honest and worked for you. And so we hired people, we had a special office with special security, and we wanted to find police officers who were not corrupt, who could tell the story of what was happening. So that was a big important thing. And out of that came a reorganization of the police department and the disappearance of the police payoff system, which had been going on for several decades.
Pas një hetimi intensiv, proceset gjyqësore i zhvilluan mes viteve 1971 dhe 1981. 20 persona u akuzuan, ndërsa 6 prej tyre morën dënime me burg, ndërsa të tjerë u larguan nga shërbimi policor. Ish prokurori Bailey tha se qëllimi i gjithë hetimit ishte që të dekonspirohet një sistem i tërë i policisë i përfshirë në korrupsion dhe kjo sipas tij më pas ka ndihmuar që të ndërmerren disa reforma të thella në polici që ndihmuan rregullimin e kësaj gjendje. Reformat në drejtësi, rritja e transparencës, kërkesa për llogaridhënie dhe instalimi një kulture kundër korrupsion përmes programeve të ndryshme kanë ngritur nivelin e vetëdijsimit dhe madje mund të thuhet që korrupsioni në Seattle tash ka arritur në nivelin zero. Anit Hayes, prokurore në Departamentin e Drejtësisë, Tregon se si zyra asaj punon vazhdimisht për t'i ruajtur dhe kultivuar parimet të përbashkëta që është askush mbi ligjin dhe duart larg korrupsionit. Hayes rëfen se njerëzit në Seattle sot nuk kanë frikë të raportojnë korrupsionin. Ata mbrohen nga shteti, pasi pothuaj se çdo kush e mbikëqyr çdo kë për punën që duhet ta bëjë në bazë të ligjit.
We have some laws that essentially say to people who are inside organizations and inside government, if you see someone abusing the law or not doing what they should be doing, you can come forward and you will be protected. We call those whistleblower laws. So someone who's a whistleblower blows the whistle and says, wait, stop, someone's doing something wrong. They're protected inside government and inside other institutions. And so we incentivize people to come forward and identify when people are corrupt and doing things against the law. We similarly, inside government, have something called inspectors general. And so, for instance, inside the Department of Justice, and that's the ministry that I work for, inside the Department of Justice, we have an inspector general whose job it is every single day to investigate misconduct, fraud, waste, and abuse inside the Department of Justice. And so we police ourselves. As part of every single part of government, we have these inspectors general to make sure that we're actually doing what we say we're going to be doing. And to the extent we either have individuals who are breaking the law, or we have entire institutions that are not doing what's required by law.
Hayes shton se kontrollat e vazhdueshme dhe besimi ndaj ligjit ka shtuar raportime të qytetarëve. Ajo përmend edhe një rast lidhur me një proces hetimi që çoi deri te akuza dhe dënimi.
The second group of people that we prosecute pretty regularly are folks who are employed by government in some way, but again, violate the law. So a perfect example of someone that we've prosecuted in the last few years and how we learned about him is important too. This was somebody who works for the IRS, our Internal Revenue Service, the folks who collect taxes. He met with someone who was running a business and he essentially offered to take a bribe in exchange for lowering the amount of taxes this individual needed to pay. The great thing was this business owner went and talked to a lawyer and said, boy, the IRS came and they're asking me to pay money, a bribe. And that lawyer called our office and said, hey, someone's come forward. And we were able to then to investigate that and hold that government official accountable for that misconduct.
Në Seattle, sot janë të vendosura kompani gjigante që kanë ndikim në botë, si Amazon, Microsoft dhe Facebook. Ata numrojnë mijëra të punësuar, ndërsa ajo që solli këto kompani aty ishte pikërisht sundimi i ligjit. Seattle ndryshoi në momentin që njerëzit atje filluan të zbatonin ligjet e shtetit. Pete Holmes është prokurori i qytetit në Seattle. Ai nuk emërohet nga asnjë institucion, por zgjedhet drejt për drejt me votë të qytetarëve. Aktualisht, po ushtron mandatin e tretë dhe për këtë thotë se është përparësi që ai të bëjë punën e tij pa ndërhyrje.
We have pretty strict elections laws. Again, the main component of an election law is the disclosure requirements. You're required to file for office by a certain deadline. You have to disclose most of your assets. I mean, you don't have to disclose everything. You have to disclose your net worth. You have to disclose every campaign contribution you receive and how you spend it. You have to file periodic reports throughout the campaign. They're posted on a public website. And they're all centered around an election date on the calendar.
Kur krahason punën mes viteve 80 dhe 90 në Seattle, prokurori Holmes tregon se ka përparim pasi korrupsioni sipas tij është më lehtë të parandalohet për shkak të transparencës. Ai thotë se llogaridhënia dhe presioni i qytetarëve parandalon çdo gjë.
If you're a member of the public, you have the right to see everything the government does. And even with the police, and consequently, it means that the benefit of the doubt goes to the requester, to the public,
and the burden is on the government to prove why something should not be released. And it's quite difficult, and the penalties are quite onerous. For instance, if a government wrongly withholds documents, the penalty can be $100 a day for each document, plus attorney fees. So if you have to sue, you can get sizable. But we've had awards against the state government, for instance, in the millions of dollars. So there are some lawyers that specialize in making public records requests and in reviewing public records requests and in pursuing inadequate responses. So it's quite an industry. Lawyers can make a lot of money suing the government.
Holmes thot se qeveria fillon të friksohet kur qytetarët interesohen për vendimet dhe veprimet e saja.
Number one, be involved and insist on knowing what your government's doing. You have a right to know, even if the law doesn't recognize it. We all have a right to know what our government is doing. And if you're involved, if you're demanding to know, that's half of the battle. If the government knows that you care, if the government knows that you're watching them, there's an old saying that people shouldn't fear the government should fear the people. And all you have to do there is really to show that you are interested and you are watching. And then you'll start to find more and more legislators will get on board, start to give you the tools to find out. Develop your own public records law. Develop, you know, the statutory support so that the rule of law ultimately prevails. I mean, I have to pull this out at some point, but, you know, I carry the Constitution with me everywhere. But that's ultimately what I'm talking about, is it's the rule of law. But it has to start first with the people demanding and insisting on knowing what the government's doing.
Se sa e rëndësishme është transparenca dhe puna e vazhdueshme në reforma, tregon edhe Jason Mercier, drejtori I Qendrës për Reforma në Qendrën e Politikave në Washington. Ai thotë se në vazhdimsi mbajnë takime publike dhe informojnë qytetarët për secilin aktivitet të qeverisë.
Particularly in Washington State, we are looking at public meetings, public records, campaign finance information, so you can see who's contributing, how much. On the public records, we make it very clear that the government does not own the documents. The people do, because you're working on our behalf. So we want to know, what memos are you sending? Who are you communicating with? How are you reaching the decisions that you're reaching? And that's particularly important on the public meetings. We have a very good process that when we have a state official or a city official about to make a decision, whether it's on tax policy or environment or housing, they have to keep the public informed.
Mercier insiston se qytetarët janë ata që duhet të qeverisin me vendin. Ata janë që zgjedhin dhe duhet të kërkojnë transparencën. Seattle, siç thot Mercier, është I pastër nga korrupsioni, sepse qytetarët janë të angazhuar të pyesin, kërkojnë llogaridhënie dhe raportojnë. Shtetet me demokraci të zhvilluar investojnë me vite dhe shumë për të vetësuar qytetarët për kërkim të transparencës dhe llogaridhënies, si një ndër instrumentet kryesore për luftë kundër korrupsionit. Kosova në këtë mes, sfidë kryesore ka korrupsionin. Vendi nuk rënditet mirë në listat botërore ku paraqitet lufta kundër kësaj dukurie. Prandaj porositë dhe përvoja në SBA duhet të shërbejnë për zbatim të politikave të njëjta, në mënyrë që korrupsioni të luftohet, raportohet dhe të gjykohet.